First, we'll go to public comment. Does anybody have something to say? Okay, that's good. Reports, police department.
Mr. Chairman, I just had a few. My written reports are in your packet. I just have a few things I want to mention. On March 17th, starting around 1:30, the police department and Montgomery County Radio Room will present a program to the grade school kids from K to second grade on 911, when to call, and how to call. So that should be an interesting program. Mm-hmm. Beaver Hill Condos called yesterday, and they would like me to give a talk about fraud to the residents there. So I don't have that date yet. They're going to get back to me. But I think it's an interesting topic. A lot of people are falling for scams and fraud over the telephone.
On the internet.
And I think it's an important topic that people should know about.
Chief, maybe, if you do that, you could actually send out one of your blasts, just, highlighting some
sure.
of the main tips
yeah.
for live,
yeah.
so it's an issue.
And yeah. And on the 31st of this month, and the 1st of April, I'll be attending a multi-agency conference on fair and impartial policing at the training center in Conshohocken. Now, this is in accordance with the president's 21st century policing plan. President Obama's program on 21st century policing. So all the Montgomery County police chiefs are going to attend, so I'll bring that back to our troops as well. So, and if you have any questions, I'll be glad to answer.
Thank you, Chief. Pioneer?
All good.
Okay, well, what about independent?
You have the department report?
Yes.
A couple months ago, I made mention of our continuing effort with Beaver Hill. We were down there for fire drills and inspections, and we're continuing to move forward to make that building a more fire-safe environment. Along with the myself and the manager's office, we're doing sprinkler inspections and doing some better identification for not only the residents but the visitors of that building, as well as the emergency services that have to go into that building, as far as labeling stair towers and mapping and so on and so forth. But it's an ongoing effort, and we're still moving at what I would consider a reasonable pace forward to the ultimate goal. Other than that, that's about it.
Well, thank you for doing that. Certainly, I don't live in Beaver Hill, but they're my near neighbor, and anything you can do to help is always good. Anything we can do to support your effort, obviously. I think I speak for everybody.
Yes, thank you. Thank you very much.
All right, second alarmers.
Just what was my report? It should be in your back, I imagine.
New business. Fire department training assessment, final report. Well, I know it's been distributed because I've got my copy and I've been reading it. And I think we had a brief discussion of it. And, Has anybody else been able to chew through it? And does anybody have anything to say? Or would we like another month to really look at it some more? Okay.
I'm just getting into it. I got it. Obviously, I was absent for the fire commission meeting, but I have received it, and I am going back through it. going between the draft and the final and whatnot, so yeah, a little bit more time would be appreciated.
Yes, sir.
I just want to acknowledge that the two departments have already taken steps on a number of the findings. There are training officers, they are coordinating the efforts. I know the next agenda item is to talk about the fire marshal position, and so those are all steps that the chiefs and their departments have taken based on this report on earlier drafts, and I want to just say we appreciate that.
Yeah, because there's nothing, if you see something when you're going through doing one of these inspections or whatever, and you know that it's something you can improve on, there's no need to wait for the report to partial part-time position. I know the ads have been placed in the newspaper, the website, and Montgomery County Community College. What have we got, Mr. Manager, for a response?
Yeah, it did go into that. Well, it was registered today. I don't know the day that it starts showing, but it'll be in for 3 days. Mm-hmm. We picked the package, it would show it 3 days and put it online. It's after college is being one of them, and then the monster.com. Mm-hmm. So we were able to get the ad together and get it in.
Okay, so it's too early to get any real response.
Yes, sir.
Fire commission meeting. When did we schedule for that?
So we have one, and we've got another one scheduled for the second month. It was on a Thursday. It's Wednesday the 22nd at 6:30 p.m.
That's going to be here, right?
That's right. We're going to have it here.
So the 22nd is the Montgomery County
Open House. What time is that open house?
5 to 8.
5 to 8.
Which house should we have the fire commission meeting at? I think it's Independence turn, isn't it?
Yeah, our house.
Can I have it at our house?
Okay.
Let's
do it independent.
Fine.
At
6:30?
Yes, please.
And that's a
22nd? Yep.
Yes, sir.
Thank you.
Thank you for that. Anything else on these? Okay. Old business, accessible walkway to playground, phase one completed, phase two connecting walking grant activities. Any discussion? Second. Yes?
Mr. Chair, we did complete phase one last Saturday. The handrails were installed.
Mm-hmm.
The phase two connecting walk is the volunteer group for the playground is raising money to do that portion of it.
All right.
They're going to need to move one swing set, and they're going to do a connecting walk between the existing blacktop walk that they have at the school and the new concrete walk. The grant activity, well then, we've actually started that, and that's going to be, basically it's going to be a couple of pieces of equipment that Councilor Farrell could fill you in more on, a drop zone, I believe, and another piece of equipment, and then plantings, natural plantings going down to it.
What's a drop
zone? $20,000.
Okay. So let me tell you about the drop zone. It sounded like 4 years ago when Doylestown, they've had like a three-phase renovation. It's a larger scale, 20-year-old wooden castle, and they have similar issues that it's hard to build onto those structures, so you have to find structures that will like be adjacent to it. It can connect to it, but not be physically connected to it because the structure is old. And so anyway, so they have this drop zone there, which is basically you step onto it, it's a platform, and it's with the kids' momentum, it spins them around and they go down. And there's like a little hydraulic lift that goes back up. It's very cool. It was by far the most popular item at the playground that day. And so 3 years ago, I came back and started talking about it to George and the old assistant borough manager, and the grant all kind of came around this $8,000 drop zone we wanted to put in at the playground, but we needed funding for it. So it's been a long process, you know, but part of it became the accessibility pathway, which will also improve, you know, definitely, you know, it's an improvement for the playground. So like I said, it's been a long time coming, but it's finally coming to fruition. So
it's exciting.
It is exciting. Yeah, and we've done a lot of successful fundraising around the accessibility path. Mm-hmm. I believe we've met our target. We should sit down and meet though, and you know, make sure all our ducks are in a row with that.
Okay.
So I'll touch base with you after the meeting.
Thank you for all the hard work.
Thank you.
All right. Next, timing of which I hear about a lot. Time of traffic. This one. Having the traffic light Greenwood Summit Township line status update. So what's up?
They reset the timing. They gave longer time coming from west up over the bridge. They improved the one at Summit. There is no longer a queue if you drive through where the video, where the camera is actuated.
you can drive past that point now and it still starts your queue before it can not recognize you.
Mm-hmm.
So there are the improvements they made. We were pushing them to do their full-blown study on it, but now that this closing of Township Line for the water main work, that's going to be, Mike's in the audience and he's the inspector on it, our fire chief from Pioneer, but they're telling me June that that'll be, we'll have activity out there by June. I mean, one thing is going to cut down on traffic from it, but we're not going to, they're not going to come out and do a traffic engineering study with one of the road shuttles.
It wouldn't be a real study then.
Mm-hmm.
So, okay, well, just, you seem to be doing, you, believe me, I haven't heard nearly as many complaints from my neighbors recently. Because they had very, very unprintable things to say about that light.
I would say they slowed down at your town hall, too.
Mm-hmm. So, see, I'm in the yard. You can at least hide your office. But anyway, okay, the next item, school safety zone lights project and Walnut Street update. So what's going on here?
They have installed, Mr. Chair, they have installed all four foundations now. Two on west waiting for the existing lights that will now hold the new lights. Okay. And then there's two on Walnut. The foundations are in place. The lights were ordered. They told us it was 4 weeks, and it's been about 3 weeks since they told us that. So we're hoping it's very soon they get them in and get them hooked up. And we had some issues. They started some work without telling the resident they were working in front of their house. It's basically a PennDOT job. They inform us. They informed us late, like 2 hours after they started working. They were going to start working. We communicated the best we could. There was one of the residents was on, you know, unhappy with that notification, which is understandable. So we're going to work in front of the house, they certainly should tell you. But PennDOT kind of just did their own drum. They're out here on 611 doing the same thing. I mean, we had business owners walking in today that came into work today, and it was the first they heard that they would be working in front of that building. That's the update I have on it. It's moving forward. Where they're connecting the electric is either existing or very close, so that's not going to be a large portion of the project. Okay. It's going to be basically installed at this point.
Okay, so that's good. Now, resident concerns regarding Walnut Street.
This was the fellow that lived on Robin, the committee. He asked us if we could put a stop sign at Robin and Walnut. We wrote down all of the requests we have, and the traffic engineer is setting up an appointment with Dave Adams, who is the county. He's in charge of PennDOT for Montgomery County. So they're setting up a meeting with him to discuss it. The other, in the same area, we applied for that high safety, low cost grant, and PennDOT approved it.
Mm.
Pannoni designed it. They accepted the design. I'm told they started doing one calls out there to install. The residents called me today and said there was a sign that said new pole for the narrow. So, and another resident actually thought a new sign went up. So they said they would be doing it in the springtime. So hopefully they're starting on that. They need a little bit warmer more weather to do the striping.
Mm-hmm.
But we're going to have that curve restripe for new signage. The plan was to shoot it back then.
Sorry, I just have a comment. I mean, just it's insane that we're not notified before they go out and start, you know, putting holes in the ground. You know, I just can't believe that we don't get notification before they start projects in our town. And I know there's nothing you can do about it, and it's a frustration constantly, but I mean, we can express our, that's a challenge for us to plan and to prepare our residents for possible inconveniences when we have no idea ourselves when they're starting these projects. Yes, they said the spring, but maybe they could give us a little bit more heads up than that. Lodge my complaint with you.
Certainly it would be nice if we would have, if we would know better than 2 hours after it starts.
The issue with such projects is PennDOT subsidies projects and the contractor shows up on the job site whenever they please. So it would be a good idea to mention it to PennDOT, but usually it would have been done, I mean, because they show up, and sometimes they try to cover multiple projects in one day. They just show up. That's not right, but yeah, it should be brought to PennDOT's attention.
Sounds like PennDOT needs a different set of contractors.
These are your long-term contractors that they have.
Like I said, it sounds like PennDOT needs a different set of contractors. So, okay, next, Green, you have, yes, sir.
On that, then, Mr. Chairman, water speed's always been a concern from a lot of people, including the board. We did a traffic study there, the police department did. We have our traffic counter out. I sent an email out to you guys. We had it out. We put it out on February 18th at 7 p.m. and we removed it on February 23rd at 11 p.m. So it was out for 5 days between Robin and Cheltina, right around by the bend. And I was very surprised at the reading. Not really surprised, but it kind of confirmed what we thought all along. The accidents on Walnut Street, from the police department's perspective, was a result of stop sign violations and DUIs. So, here are the numbers that we counted in those 5 days in both directions on Walnut. We counted 29,000 cars. And the median speed, the highest speed was 47.
47?
The median speed was 26 miles per hour.
What's the posted speed?
25. Yeah, three cars out of the 29,000 were clocked at 42, 44, and 47.
But half the cars were going faster than the speed limit.
Yeah. So what, and the speed counter tells you what enforceable is a high, low, or medium enforceable ratio. In this case, it said we had a low enforcement. So what it means is if the police department's going to go out and do speed enforcement, based on those readings, we'd be wasting our money and wasting our time. So we should be focusing on the stop sign enforcement, which we do anyway. We don't really focus on the speed on Walnut because we're not finding, you know, speed. We're finding people on the stop sign. Mm-hmm. But the speed issue is, here's the number for the 5 days that we collect.
So,
mm-hmm.
Chief, is that Walnut from west to Runnymede, or is it from Washington Lane to Runnymede?
No, it was from west to Runnymede.
So you're talking about that one stop sign at Hillside?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Like when you pass the stop sign.
Yeah.
That's, we had that speed counter up there.
Okay.
Right around the bend where most of the accidents are occurring. You know, and so the accidents that we see, the accident data that we collect in all the streets around the borough, speed is really low as a result of the data that we're collecting. It's human error. It's stop sign violations, running the red light, DUIs. That's what's causing the majority of the accidents in Jayden. I just want to look at that.
Well, what would you suggest we, I mean, I know you've been talking about some things, but is there something we're not doing that we should be?
No, I think we're doing all the right things, and this, what we're doing on Walnut Street now, with the that only enhances the safety of that curb and the street. So everything we're doing is good. And we've done a lot of work from Washington Lane to Runnymede, pretty much over the years to solve the problem. And it has solved the problem on the other part of Walnut between Summit and Washington Lane.
Right, we got the speed humps.
We have the speed humps. We have a no left turn, which there are zero accidents there in the last 5 years. Mm-hmm. We have the blinking red light at Winco. We identified all the high accident areas around the borough. some years back. And we counted up the accidents, and there were a tremendous amount of accidents in all the areas that we addressed. Washington and Wincote, Walnut and Washington, Hillside and Walnut, Walnut Street was speeding with that nonsense, we put the speed humps in. So we've addressed all the issues that the residents were concerned about. And we're now seeing the results that we lost our grit for
doing too good a job?
Yeah, we were being actually punished for not enforcing what we needed to enforce as much.
So I have a question, Chief, and maybe it's, I'll just ask the question. Over in Rockledge, driving down Shady when I go over to the park, they've got a little sign up on the stop sign. So it's a normal stop sign, and below it, it says complete stops free, rolling stops, $113.
Well, that thing's off.
Yeah, they don't work?
Well, can I just explain that?
Please.
You know, it's a novelty, I think. My own opinion is a novelty.
Yeah.
They're expensive.
Mm-hmm.
Every year you have to change them because the fines change every year. Nobody, if you're not going to see the stop sign, why would you read the little sign? That's my take on it. If you're not going to read this where it says stop, that little sign there is not going to make you stop. I don't think. They're not seeing a reduction in accidents.
So that's what I was going to ask if there was any.
No, they're not seeing a reduction in accidents.
Okay.
We're seeing a reduction in accidents because we're enforcing it.
Yeah.
And so that's why we're seeing it. I think they're useless. And every year we'd have to change the sign because the fines change. We want to be accurate and honest. Can't tell people it's going to be $100 when next year it's going to be $115. I think we're stupid, to tell the truth.
All right, that's the question.
I might disagree with you. I don't think it's a good idea. For. I'll tell you what, I'd be glad to put them up if it comes out of somebody else's budget.
I wanted to know. You're the professional. You know if they work. I have no idea if they work. Now, what about the ones, if I just follow on, the ones that say, like, intensive traffic enforcement zone or whatever, do those do anything?
They're good. But here's the problem with permanent signage.
Yeah.
They're good for a while. Just like the things you put on your lawn where it says, slow down, kids are playing. On the onset, people listen to those, and they read those things, and they do slow down. When you have a permanent sign, it becomes just part of the landscape, becomes part of the tree and the shrub, and before long, nobody pays attention to it at all. That's why permanent signs aren't good. Occasional signs will be put up. Like, when we do a massive traffic enforcement in the borough, mm-hmm. I always put something out prior to that to let people know that be aware, we're going to be around the borough, we're having an aggressive traffic enforcement detail today, and whatever, and just so you know. So that kind of catches people's attention more. And it kind of lasts longer, I think, and after it's over, they still tend to stop at the stop signs and slow down a little bit more. Mm-hmm. The permanent signs are, just like when you see those signs in Abington, traffic enforcement,
yeah.
They have that traffic enforcement program at when school opens up. But they tell you to take them down when school closes because they become part of the landscape. It's people don't pay attention to them.
So Chief, we've sort of actively tried to improve safety on that street with enhancements to the signage and the reflective lines and things. I'm thinking about that stop sign, though, which seems like the root of a lot of these problems. And just an idea, when we were having issues of people not stopping at the Greenwood and Walnut intersection, we put the very low-cost flashing lights on top of the stop sign. And I honestly didn't think they'd do anything, but they have. The residents around there have said there's better, people are stopping. It draws their attention. They seem to be working. I don't know if we would think about those sorts of those flashing lights on top of the stop sign at Walnut and Hillside. Just an idea. You think it might be effective?
Counselor, Those blinking red lights are good. And that was an idea George and I spoke about. We put those lights up and kind of alleviated the problem.
It did.
It really did.
Mm-hmm.
But not only the traffic, not just the blinking lights. If you notice.
Right. You did enforcement there.
The police car's there a lot.
Right. Mm-hmm.
We're not seeing a whole lot of accidents at Walnut and Hillside.
I thought you said that stop sign and folks running through that and missing that stop sign are causing the accidents
right.
that then result down.
But when there's an accident in that area, it's a result of probably two things.
Speeding and not going through.
The operator probably ran, somebody ran a stop sign, ran into somebody. Or, like I said, you find driving under the influence, they run on something.
Although I have to say it's rough for pedestrians sometimes.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But we're not, the data that we have at that particular intersection, we don't see a lot of accidents. I don't think we had 5 accidents last year at Hillside and Walnut.
Yeah, I was just trying to think of other measures we could do to draw people's attention to, traffic calming.
And at the intersection where the gentleman spoke about a few months ago, he wanted a stop sign at Rodman.
Right.
We have 0 accidents there. But if you cross on Walnut Street.
He was talking about specifically when you're
crazy.
Crossing there.
Yeah,
my granddaughter walks up there to go to school, and I tell her, please don't cross that street. So I think we're doing everything that we're doing our due diligence with what the engineering people are doing. We're enforcing that stop sign. We're checking the speed. And I think the more when they do the lines and those barriers, you're going to see it really, you're going to see it just drop down almost nothing, I think.
Not much of you
but anything, anything that we do with any intersection around the borough certainly helps.
Sure.
Not just that intersection. If we put red lights on all the stop signs, it certainly helps on everything that we do helps.
Mm-hmm.
But the permanent signs just become part of the landscape. I think maybe Cal would agree with that.
I kind of agree about the speed info. Actually, I come in here, I just passed by one coming from Hamilton. After a while, when you see it on a regular basis, you can attend the, I know there's a sign.
That doesn't mean it.
But that doesn't say that a trooper is not just, around the corner just waiting for me if I'm speeding. So I guess it goes both ways. Well, for this one here, PennDOT, Dave Adams is going to be coming. They're going to be asking for any backup information, and they'll take it from there. If they deem that something enforceable should be taking place, then that's a decision.
Is he the same one we talked to about getting different contractors?
No. Dave Adams is the signal person, and the contractors that we're talking about just relate to maintenance.
I would like to talk to somebody about, let's get some people here that have a little bit of, remember, the contractors seem to forget these are taxpayers,
mm-hmm.
and they really don't love having things sprung on as far as, and then they come and beat up poor George and even me. And, I'd really rather that not happen.
No, I agree.
Mr. Chairman, we did have a pre-construction meeting with PennDOT and the contractor, and they were directed to put door hangers on the residents, and they went through their whole. PennDOT has a checklist, and they just run through everything, and then at the end of it, after everybody's agreed to it, everyone signs it, and they give the contractor a copy. So they were aware they had to do it, and it is a publicly bid contract, but as Cal suggested, it's the same 3 or 4 big firms that did all their work.
We're not saying it won't go anywhere. We will make sure PennDOT is notified. PennDOT will probably contact the contractor and make sure they understand that you cannot be doing this. As George has mentioned, it's all discussed and reviewed with the contractor of the pre-construction meeting. But every once in a while, you have some of these contractors, they want to rush in here and there so that they cover multiple projects, and this way they drop the requirements of notifying people on what time they're supposed to go. But we'll notify maintenance.
I don't have a whole lot of sympathy for those contractors. Frankly, I have sympathy for our citizens.
Understood.
Okay. Next, we have Greenwood Avenue School Safety Zone update. What's going on, George?
Greenwood Avenue, that was approved by PennDOT to install it. Actually, I don't have an update for you. I'm just repeating myself, but for those that haven't heard, it was approved to be a school zone without the flashing lights, similar to what we had on Walnut Street. And Panoni had designed a plan, and that was submitted to PennDOT. And that plan, we have not got approval yet, but we anticipate it. And when we have the approval, we're going to be able to use some of it may be available.
The people that come out of that parking lot there do not pay much attention. And luckily, we haven't had any big accidents there. Sooner or later, they won't, because they come out with a cell phone in their ear and pay no attention. So. Oh, let's see. Anybody else got anything to say about that? Okay. Let's see. Walnut Street signal been submitted rather than PennDOT through. Include the PennDOT grant? Anything more we need to say about that, Mr. Fender?
No, sir. I think we covered that along with number four.
Right. Okay. Striping on 300 block of Florence Playground. Have we talked about that specifically yet?
No. We had talked about it at public safety, but Panoni provided a plan on proposed locations. There was different limitations on where it could go with line of sight and some other factors, but we do have a meeting set up on Monday, March 13th at 10 a.m. on site to make site observations.
Can I come out and meet you guys?
You're absolutely welcome.
So is it 10?
10 a.m., yes, on Monday. And Mark Bickerton from Panoni Associates Traffic Engineer will be out there.
The positive news from us is the location has been identified, possible location. It meets the minimum setbacks. So it cannot be less than 300 feet from the closest crossing.
Okay.
In this case, there's a potential location, but as George mentioned, a site visit is absolutely required and necessary to make sure that other elements are also met for safety.
Okay. Yeah. I think, they'll just miss, they're going to miss all the kids, but there's so many kids that walk by themselves.
Mm-hmm.
Young kids, so it really is important there because they can't see. The cars are, the cars parked there. And people, I don't know if it's ever been clocked there, but not many people are going 50 miles per hour on Florence, and that's what it's posted.
And it's before and after school. So after school, especially when the kids are coming from the playground, from the school, and all the cars are parked there, it's really hard for them to see both. I mean, cars are going really fast. So I've witnessed it's quite dangerous for the little ones.
And children are children. So the little ones are not they should have to make it safer for them for that reason.
Yes, as part of this process, proper signage will be introduced and hopefully makes it more safer.
Okay.
Anything else on that?
Thank you.
Anyway, the last item here, we discussed the South Police Department request for change in language of the rural code. Word H to National Accreditation Standards, so it already has a change. Is there anything you need to discuss, Mr. Chairman?
Yes, so Mr. Chairman, we would like permission, we would like you to make a motion to take that to council for permission to advertise that ordinance. It was provided in Dropbox late this afternoon. The solicitor sent it over, the police reviewed it, and it says what they need it to. There's some minor changes in the language to it to coincide with their accreditation and the civil service rules.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Chairman, when you read this ordinance, it says a lot of things about the structure of a police department. We don't have cabins and all that business, but it's the standard says what the ordinance mm-hmm. should say. 10 years from now, you might want to have a cabin. I don't know. But this standard meets the CALEA accreditation standard that we have to meet from the assessor's office. Right now, the borough code and the standard don't match what we have. So this ordinance and the standard brings us into compliance.
Any other discussion? Okay, then I move we send this to council. A second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? I do believe that's it for public safety. Sir?
I call to order the March 8th, 2017 Public Works Committee. At this time, I'd like to open it up to public comment. Hearing none, I will move on to reports. Public Works Department, Jim.
Good evening. Our Public Works report is in the package as well as Dropbox. A couple things I'd like to highlight from this month of February. This month we had a lot of sewer repairs. We had emergency sewer repairs, which we completed 5 out of 8 of them. We're up to 8 sewer repairs. We replaced about 35 feet of sewer main. Used 9.5 tons of base and 4 tons of Colfax to restore the roads for temporary repair, just until the weather breaks and we get the mill and put an appropriate wear and course there. Right now it's base coursing with Colfax. On Washington Lane, we excavated and found the repair to be encased with concrete. That's from manhole GA2 to WL3. On Washington Lane from manhole with WL3 to WL4. I'm saying these manholes, they number like that. So
yeah, I guess.
I can tell you, well, the first one is from Greenwood Avenue to the first manhole on Washington Lane on the opposite side of York Road. And the next one will be WL3 and WL4, which will be from on Washington Lane between Greenwood and York. That line was damaged. We excavated it, took out the broken pipe, and replaced about 12 feet with PVC. It's C9. That was the PVC we used. Washington Lane, we got 2 repairs on Washington Lane on the opposite side between Wincook Road and Township Line with WL8 mail with WE9. Same thing. Excavated, found the brick in the pipe, replaced it. And we did also have the same problem on Eagle Street. Right here outside in front of the road. Y'all see the pictures? Outside of that, we had a couple sewer problems on Township Line, which we had to work hand in hand with Abington and Shellhams, Public Work Department and Sewer Crew. We flushed all the main lines in front of the building. We videotaped in front of the main and Township Line and in the back of the properties on Township Line, which we found those ladder was going in there. But
hey, jump for you on that. And George was helping out on vacation. So,
I
appreciate that.
That was a secret.
There was a lot of work. And what it turned out was the fellow that bought the house, I guess, recently in the last 3-4 years, and they told him he was hooked up to Jenkintown Sewer. In fact, he was paying for Jenkintown Sewer, so he no red flags. Mm-hmm. And then the system failed. It was an on-site system.
Oh, well.
And it eventually failed. So they're now hooking up to our sewer system. It's an odd situation. It's a Cheltenham house, mm-hmm. But they tie into our main in that area. Mm-hmm. So that's why Cheltenham coordinated with Jim, and Abington was very gracious. They came out and flushed it. Which we paid for that, but they were right out there. Mm-hmm. So all 3 departments worked mm-hmm. together. It's a good thing.
Is that what that's going to be resolved?
Is
that on its way to being resolved?
The fellow's digging out towards the main to hook up to it. Now, he's Cheltenham property, so the permits will go to Cheltenham. It looks like he's at... Cheltenham is saying there's a lateral run off the main all the way to behind the curb, so he's pretty lucky if that's the case, mm-hmm. because the sewer main's on the other side of Township Line Road. If he has to go out into the road, he's going to have to go almost the whole width of the road. Mm-hmm. It's 8 feet deep there, so I need to lose your job. I don't think it's resolved. I think Resort reached out to him, and they've been in contact with Jim a couple of times to discuss it.
100%. That problem, we got all our lines flushed around that property on Township Line, which is better for us anyway. And we got that area video cam, which is already on camera. But while we was there, showing the video cam, and so we could see the laterals going out the front of each house and all that. Mm-hmm. So right now, as far as our part, we're done on that. And it's really the owner's property problem until he gets out into the street. That's when it becomes out of there. Mm-hmm. But until then, if it happens, we're done with that. And we did a couple storm repairs. We did a couple storm repairs this month. We replaced the M-top. It's a 6-foot M-top on Cedar Street with bangs. One of those things the neighbors complained about. It's kind of uneven.
An M-top?
Yeah, that's the M that's in the middle of the street. The one going to Curtis is City Top. The one in the street is M-top. Okay. We replaced the 6-foot M-top there. Keep that noise down.
This is the one where the residents came in and complained that every time a car drove over it, it would clack. Okay.
Yeah, we replaced that. Hopefully they don't come back. And another problem with the storm. We had a city top on the corners of Florence and Runnymede Avenue, which always got crushed from bigger trucks, trash trucks, whatever local delivery. They crushed it by every other month. We had to build it, take it out. What we did this past month, we took the city top out, we collapsed it, and we brought an M-top in the middle of the street, and off the curb line, which will cut down the maintenance, and it's pretty good for flow right there because you got two city tops on opposite corners that'll take the water. That'll leave you all maintenance and all that. And as far as training, we're still training one of our crew, part-time guy, but we're training him for the CDO. He got his permit, and right now we just train him next week, I think, next Wednesday. He's supposed to take the CDL test for the driving test. He's doing real good. We're confident in that. And one of our guys, Mark, just got a CDL. He's being trained on a sweeper. It's in court right now, so he can be able to operate that. So once he gets the proper training and all that, we'll have a sweeper schedule out, and we'll get him on that around town. But that's all I got. If you have any questions, anything else?
Jimmy, you said there were 5 of these sanitary sewers running here?
5 this month. It was actually 7.
7 altogether.
7 out of 8 all. Double 2 in January, 5 this month. Right. And the 8th one, we're moving on next. That's the problem with the easement. Which actually, this Friday, we got a camera crew coming up. The video between Cedar Street and Walnut to see that problem. The further the steps, so we can know what we have to do to get to that problem.
Okay. Thank you. Moving on to the engineer's report, Cal from Padone.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. A copy of my report is in your packet. I'd like to just give you a couple of updates. The one is the small water grant. As you are aware, that the decision hopefully is going to be made sometime in March, so we are hoping it's a matter of days now when we hear from the grant office. Hopefully we get that grant. And the second update, and I'm sure the manager will be also highlighting on this subject. Today there was a mandatory municipal training session at Montgomery County Management and Development. This is regarding the 2017 CDBG grant. Just wanted to let you know that we're working with the manager on putting together the 2017 CDBG grant, which is due April 17th. The positive thing about this is it's not a fully blown grant because we're going to be using what we used last year and just add new locations of ADA ramps so we move forward with a similar grant. So that should be a pretty good cost saving to the borough if the borough wishes to move forward with this project. And eventually, it would have to come in front of council for a resolution to be attached to the grant. These are the only two highlights that I have, but I'm sure I'll answer any questions that George might have.
So it has to be submitted in April 17th?
April 17th is the due date.
17th?
Yes. April 17th, 4 o'clock.
So we would need, well, we could go ahead, we'll go ahead enough to ask them to take it to council for a resolution.
Yes, sir.
Right. And we'll come ahead enough for that.
Hey,
financing. Is that okay?
That's not a good idea.
We don't have solid numbers right now. Rather than give me a not to exceed, we'd rather give you a real good idea of what we're doing.
Yeah.
They meet on the 20th.
Okay. Yeah, that should be fine.
Yes, sir. We did have two. It's mandatory that the municipality sends people to the training. So Jim attended the training along with Rick Ware today. Consultants are welcome, but they want the commitment of the municipality to have somebody there.
Yeah, I agree. Consultants, in our case, we do send someone to represent us as PNE, but we can by no means represent any municipal entities. It's just representing ourselves. That's it for me. If you have any questions for me, I'm obligated to answer. Otherwise, I'll wait for the manager's report and answer any other questions.
Great. Thank you, Kathy.
Thank you.
Moving on to new business. One, the 2017 proposed paving project is Rodman Avenue and Linda Vista, Washington Lane, from York Road to Greenwood Avenue. And the 2017 paving project will start in August. Number two, the ADA compliance ramps on York Road. PennDOT has begun replacing the non-compliant ADA handicap ramps on York Road. And the non-compliant ramps will be replaced from Cheltenham to County Line Road. In fact, they were working on two right at the end of Summit today, I believe.
Can I ask a clarification? George, when you had officially gotten their plans, it omitted the one on Summit, crossing the one on the southbound side.
PennDOT is not installing that ramp. I did have updates, and I had a couple of meetings with Fran Haney, who was in charge of that work. I briefly spoke with both Chair of ANF and Chair of Public Works, because what came up was they're only responsible if we go across the crosswalk. The same with us, if we pave across the crosswalk, then we have to put a time frame on replacing the ramps that we disturb. Either you do them right then, or like they did, they come back a year later and do the ramps. The one that crosses, the one on Summit, they didn't pave across that crosswalk, so they're not doing it.
You're doing the one, not the other. Even though at a previous meeting, they had agreed to do that?
You're not imagining things. Everything they said in that meeting seems to have changed.
Because the other piece to that is they are putting a crosswalk across Old York Road, which we had met with them about, and they said that's not feasible. And then they seem to have changed their mind about that, again, without notification or input from the borough. And they have said, now, okay, you can have one there, but we're not going to do the other one that we said.
That is correct.
And if I recall, they said that the crosswalk is not feasible because it would actually draw people out into the street. And that's
because we wanted some sort of pedestrian safety crossing.
Yes.
We couldn't get one there. So the determination was it didn't make sense to put, it wasn't safe to put one. But now they seem to have determined something different. I feel like we need some clarification around the process that they undertook to make that decision. Because I'm not clear on it. Are we going to then get some sort of pedestrian safety device there if we're encouraging people to
create? Well, our traffic engineer, when he evaluated, recommended those rapid flashers.
They didn't like that, though. PennDOT had some issues with that.
I don't remember them having an issue with that. I know they had an issue with a traffic control device because of how close Washington and Greenwood was, but the queuing would go back through that light that they would jam up.
Right.
I remember that. But the rapid flashers, I thought our traffic engineer talked with them and said, if you want to go with them, that would be all right. That's my recollection. It has been a few months and it just came out of nowhere.
Right.
The one thing that we could do, they allowed, well, they told us we could use their contractor and pay their rate
The summit.
To do rate. That grant if we would choose to do it at the same time and make that corner all compliant. The final price if we were to do that grant was $10,200 because it's a lot of work. I mean, if you go down to Saks and see what they're doing, it's huge. Mm-hmm. It's I think it's 800 square feet of sidewalk and 60 feet of curb on our side is what it took. The contractor did the quantities can now be the price of this. With the county building there, with the court, and with the brewery making settlement and intended to open, it would probably be nice to have that whole corner compliant. The only other angle you could look at doing is putting it in this 2017 application for the CDBG. You could do that, or you could actually include it in one of the grant submittals that we're going to put in for streetscape at the moment, south from where they stopped, which was its own. To Washington, but that is something that could take years.
Right. I mean, it would make sense to wrap it up into that because we'd be looking at all those ramps anyway for that project. But there's no guarantee that that's going to happen.
And it would take years regardless.
So I seem to think that we would need to get in touch with them about that crosswalk, the past conversations we had. And some kind of that light, what they had talked about.
Our engineer talked about the rapid flashing.
Yeah.
Yeah, we need some sort of, I mean, we're building ramp, you know, handicap ramps to lead people right into the traffic of your road. Yeah. I mean, we need some sort of pedestrian crossing place there.
I can call for that more.
All right, thanks, George. Free the 2000 CDBG grant training class, March 8th, as George and Cal and Jim himself mentioned, Greg and Jim attended that this afternoon. For the Aqua Water Lane, Washington Lane north from York Road, the Township Line Road from Washington Lane to Summit Avenue. I believe we've already been updated on that. You said that was going to run until June?
The Township Line is scheduled to be working until June 1st.
Okay. Five, the Pico Gas Lane Replacement Project, the status update. The quarterly avenue is completed and they've begun work on I don't recall where they're going to do that. George, do you know what the...
We received an updated schedule today that I plan on posting.
Okay.
I asked for permission from Pico and they said we could post it. They just cautioned that it's a construction schedule and it changed with weather. Or,
right.
You know, if they have a rough week, it could be slower than that. So they had some concerns with publishing, but they said we could publish it.
Can I back it up to number four really quickly?
Sure.
With the Aquame? So the June, the period of work through June, that surprises me. I wonder, have we communicated to those residents that they can expect that work through June?
PennDOT is, Aqua has communicated with them.
That they can expect it till June or that it's just happening?
They receive letters.
Specifically saying that they could expect this work to continue through
the start date to the approximate end date.
Okay. I just feel like that sounds like a long time, and I want to make sure folks are...
And being that that's a state road, they had to have an official detour set, and they had that approved, and there's a detour plan.
No, I know. I just want to make sure we're communicating with our residents about what they can expect. Thank you.
6, the traffic signal maintenance contract will be leaving our consortium, and we're partnering up with Abington Township. So anytime there's an issue with our traffic signal, the maintenance will be done through Abington. Anything you wanted to add to that?
Yes, I would like to add. I put a memo in the Dropbox. I mean, in your packets, I put a memo. We met with Abington one final time. They were able to provide us the proposed contract. They would like to talk, us to talk about it at committee and then have council approve it if we'd like to enter it with me. My memo explains that the hourly rate, which is a major part of it, it's not everything, but we were paying $93 an hour. We will be paying Abington Township $66 an hour. So it's $27 an hour we will save for each billed hour. Some of the other things is they have the trained technicians. They're closer to us. We had an emergency response this weekend that we called on them for, and they responded. They had agreed to do emergency response until we get the contract approved. They took over the border lights with Cheltenham, and they had already done Rockledge, so they're pretty well versed in this. I'm very confident in talking with them after, you know, meeting the people. And
some of the people are kind of questioning.
Yeah, I wanted to know.
And
it
sounds like it's my understanding that if it is a border, it wouldn't be $66 an hour. It would be 50 to Shelton, or 50% goes to Shelton, and 50% we pay for.
Yeah, if it's a shared light, and some of them are shared in quarters or thirds. Okay. Cheltenham's in on it. They did do a list, and Jim had confirmed that list to be accurate of all the lights that it will involve. One of the downsides of the consortium was they went from 3 to 2 employees, and they were overwhelmed. They were doing emergency responses mostly, but they weren't doing maintenance. And maintenance is a very important part of the traffic signals. It's required by PennDOT once a year that they go through the maintenance through a checklist. And if there's an accident, it's the first thing that the attorney asks for. So the first couple months of this contract, they've already looked in all of our traffic boxes. They know what they're up against. But there will be more maintenance than had been performed before. But once we're up and running, it will be a huge cost saving by going with these guys. And they have all the supplies they need. I mean, it's really a good situation. With this contract, they would also take care of our street lights. One of the reasons we approached them before, one of the reasons they couldn't, is we had a lot of lights going out all the time. And now that we're in this LED program, once they're installed as of July, we're not supposed to have those maintenance problems. And it seems like the people that have installed, including Abington, aren't having the problems they have with maintenance. So it looks like it's working out to be the case. So we would just ask that you discuss this as we have, and then make a motion that council consider at the next council meeting.
Okay, so I move to enter a traffic signal maintenance contract with Abington Township.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? All right, the ayes have it. 7, the emergency sanitary sewer repairs. I think Jim went over this in great detail in his report. I'll move on to number 8, the paving estimates for joint roads shared with Abington. So as I think most of us know, that we do share roads with Abington. For instance, Rydal, we own one half, Abington owns the other half. So we've been talking about the paving estimates for the joint roads. I just want to go over them real quick, the roads we're talking about, and the price that each would cost. So, and this is this was for 2018, I believe, George, correct? These estimates?
These estimates for 2017.
For 2017, thank you. The bridle road from York Road to Clement Road, including both sides of the road, is estimated at 28,000. Bridle road from Clement Road to Newbold Road, which would just be the one side, because after Clement, it's just one side, is 12,400. And Washington Lane from Greenwood Avenue to York Road is estimated at 27,000. Aqua will be required to pay half of that after the completion of the water main. So that's where we are with that. So that's a decision we need to make at least by April.
Door to April, we'll be fine with them.
Okay. All right. Yes, George.
Can I speak to that,
please? Please do.
They do have five shared roads on here. One of them was Cloverly, and that did not get the chairman did not mention Cloverly, because we looked at these five roads. Cloverly was paved 6 years ago. Our side of it's in good shape. They didn't disturb our side of it. So that wouldn't be a road that I would recommend us spending $40,000 to repave that 7.5. Washington Lane between Newbold Road and Greenwood is an area where we know we're going to be doing storm work. We're going to be applying for grants, and we're going to do that in conjunction with Abington. They're going to pave their half the road where Aqua has worked, and Aqua's going to split that cost with them. But I think that we would be throwing good money after bad if the road's holding up right now. The other three, the two that Chairman mentioned about Bridle, they're in real bad shape. We spent a lot of money maintenance on them. Public Works last summer did a heck of a job patching it, but it's only going to hold up so long. We had a mild winter, so we got lucky. That bridle is something that we would recommend paving if we can afford it. And then the Washington Lane one, that's on our paving program anyway. It's Washington Lane from Greenwood to Buick. And as the chairman mentioned, whatever that price is, Aqua's going to split it with us. So we got this number from them, and it's in our bid package for our 17th paving. So whatever one was less, it's on as an alternate in our paving project. So we don't have to accept the bid on it. And if it was under 26, we could accept the bid, split the cost with Aqua. If it's over 26, and it was about that last year, but this includes the traffic loop sensors and all scrub beam. It's the full job. So even if we turned down what's on the bid and did this, it would be 27,000, so we would go to 13.5, which is pretty cheap to pay that section of the road in comparison to some of the highways cost there.
Yes.
I totally agree. That sounds like it's fine. We don't have to make that call tonight, though.
And no.
I want to hear from Rick that we've got the money and the funds.
Yes. We figured by having finance, we could come back with some numbers for you.
Yeah.
We'll know more about our pavement project. We know what we budgeted this year, mm-hmm. and it appears as though the money's there. But like you said, we're going to have Rick on.
Yeah,
we're sure that we're very comfortable. We're in a good place with that, with the paving money, so we don't want to get ourselves in trouble being overzealous. But it would be nice if we could do Rival.
Yeah.
That's all I wanted to say.
Thank you, George. Thank you, Rick.
One other thing, I'm sorry.
Yeah, that's fine.
With Abington doing this, they do this in-house. So we're basically, we're not even paying for labor. This is just material for the paving, for the milling they pay, and the paving, and the traffic loops and striping. But it's a real reduced cost from what it would cost us to do it now.
Yeah, because however we can take advantage of that, we should definitely do that. Great.
As long as somebody stays in
Okay. 9, the emergency storm water repair. The city inlet at the corner of Florence Avenue and Runnymede Avenue. I think Jim had mentioned this in his report as well. It was relocated as an M-top inlet and placed in the street. 10, the dump body truck for 23 is in stock, and the installation for that dump body is being scheduled. There's a dire need of
like that wooden.
Yeah, the wood.
God, they just want me filled to it, don't they?
It's not like a homemade filled to it. Yeah, right. The problem.
We'll keep it then.
Keep it, not use it. Yeah.
Just pick Ellie May to jump out of that thing.
Moving on to 11, the engagement letter with Pendoni Associates Incorporated as the borough traffic engineer. I just need to move this to full council, which will, I make a motion to accept the engagement letter retroactive from January 1st, 2017 from Pendoni Associates Incorporated as the borough traffic engineer.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? And I just have it. Moving on to old business. Residential solid waste and recycling collection dig that was awarded to BFI. I think our current contract goes through the end of March and picks up again with BFI in April. Mm-hmm. Number two, the PA small water grant application. I think Cal had mentioned this has been submitted, and we're waiting for the awards. They'll be up by May 2017, so we'll know in May. Runnymede Avenue, the Walnut Street traffic light repair. The insurance company and the engineer is setting up a meeting with the property owner. I believe they have to meet with the property owner because the new pole will be on the property owner's property. Yeah. Mm-hmm. 2016,
sure.
Yes.
The last time we discussed that, there had to be an assessment made to see if it was going to be too close to their house or anything. Has that been done?
It came over where they needed to go, and it isn't actually going to be set on the property. It's still within the right of way. PennDOT has a real wide right of way there. But they want to meet with the property owner because they're going to have to move a bush and it's going to just come out. So
oh, it isn't property, it's just the right way. Okay, but at least it's not
it could
like up against the house or anything.
No, it's down by the sidewalk. It would just be on the back of the sidewalk instead of the front.
That's good news. Sorry.
That's okay. 2016 paving project, the required concrete repair update. Eight notices have been sent, letting them know that it needs to be completed and that the paving starts in August. Sheltenham proposed sanitary sewer construction interceptor A. Do we have any update on that? Have you been in a meeting lately or with Sheltenham? Or?
No, sir, I do not have an update on that.
All right.
I believe they said April, May they would be bidding it.
Okay, all right.
And I haven't heard anything change.
Yeah, I didn't think there was any. 2016 CDBG grant, the accessible curb cut grants. That grant, when you received that grant, it was in the amount of $156,000.
Yes.
I believe it enables us to do 22 ramps, we're doing, I believe.
Yeah, it was 32, and just as an update, survey and design are moving forward.
And
the
long, narrow planners on North Road.
The EAC is going to be doing some native plantings around town in some different areas, and maybe we can check them out and see if some of those plants might be good to go in those long planters.
And before I adjourn, I do want to go back to number 11 under new business. The reason the engagement letter is retroactive from January 1st for Pendoni is because there was I believe a 3% increase in the fees involved. So for that reason, it has to go to full council. So I just wanted to clarify. Mm-hmm.
Thank you for the transparency.
You're welcome. My pleasure. That would be okay. Anybody have anything else for the good of the? A motion to adjourn?
Mm-hmm.
All in favor?
Aye.